Of announcements. So those of you that have the baby bottles from Echoes, make sure that you get them back by Father's Day weekend, please. If you don't have one, I've got three bottles left. And what that is to benefit the Ministry of Echoes, and all the money goes into all the different programs and that. You just fill it up with change, bring it back. We got a bucket in the back there that you can drop it in. And after Father's Day, we take it over and give it to him. I'd throw it, but I'm afraid I hit DJ in the head.
Oh. Oh, there you go.
Last one. All right, I'll get to keep one. Oh, Mama's going to take it. There we go. All right, so just make sure we bring those back. Father's Day weekend, if you would, please. Mr. Ron Oppenthal is coming up June 7th, 8th, and 9th.
Yes, we will have a good morning. We've got quite a few people going through right now, but we definitely have room for more. The theme for this one is Call on the Lord. And it's going to be a good one. We've never had a bad one.
No.
As long as Jesus shows up.
There you go. So I throw the same deal out every time. It's $50, right? Still $50 to go through the weekend. It's a 3-day weekend. Takes care of all your stuff while you're there. It's worth every dime that you spend on that. So if you go through, you pay the $50. You're not on a scholarship. You pay the money to go through. And you have to go all the way through to Sunday. You come out on the other end of Sunday and you do not like Oppenthal, I'll give you $100 cash. So I've been doing this for 24 years. I have still got my $100 in my pocket. So the weekend will touch you. The weekend will bless you. So how many have been to Oppenthal? Oh, we got a whole bunch. So look around, just see who doesn't have their hand raised up. I do have the applications up here. Ron will have some stuff, so if you would like to go Friday morning through Sunday late afternoon, come grab one of these and get hooked up with that, okay? And we got a little video from Mikey in Sturgis.
What's happening, Set Free? We're down here hanging out at Harley-Davidson Square here in downtown Sturgis today, Memorial Day weekend. Shops are starting to open up just down here. Been walking up and down Main Street, talking to people and trying to share some Jesus. Was able to talk to one guy, same guy that I talked to last year when we did our meet and greet. He said he won't come into church, but he'll hang out and talk. And we talked for, man, I don't know, 35, 40 minutes. And he said, why do you keep doing this? And I told him, I said, you know, and this was the crazy part. Almost had me in tears, but today is a 5-year anniversary of getting saved and delivered. And I told him, I said, this is why I do it, because God shed his grace on me. And I just want to share that same opportunity to each and every person I come in contact with. You know, the Bible says that we're to preach the gospel to everyone. That's all of us. Hey, man, I love you guys. Miss you. Looking forward to seeing some of you this summer. And we're down here at the Harley-Davidson Square. We're going to be looking at trying to find out for some opportunities on maybe Saturday afternoons, getting down here and doing a little bit of outreach. And things are starting to get busy down here. Sun shines out. There ain't no more snow. That's a good thing. Love you guys. We'll talk to you soon. God bless.
We're going to take an offering up for Mikey, because he's got the same problem that I do. So you got to look through your bifocals. So we're going to take an offering up and get him a selfie stick so he can get Oh, but 5 years ago today, I run into that guy. He smelt to high heaven. Just come up out of the mountains. Reeked of booze, was dirty, unbelievable. And Pastor Anvil in Missoula come up to me and said, this guy wants to come to the program. I said, hey, he's got to be sober for a week. And by gosh, he went and moved in with Warlord for a week. And Warlord brought him up after that, and he's been set free ever since. So God's amazing. God is amazing. Cowboy, you are on.
All right, please join me in our set free pledge. Rebecca, just give me an evil eye. Yeah. Yep, see, see. I am part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I have Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I've stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I'm a disciple of Jesus. I won't look back or let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense. My future is secure. I'm finished and done with low living, sidewalking, cheap giving, and dwarf goals. I no longer need preeminence, prosperity, position, promotion, or popularity. I don't have to be right, recognized, praised, regarded, or recorded. I live by faith, walk by patience. My face is set, my gate is fast, my goal is heaven, my road is narrow, my way is rough, my companions are few. My guide is reliable, my mission is clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, deterred, hired away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice or hesitate in the presence of the enemy. I will not give up, shut up, let up till I've stayed up, prayed up. I will give till I drop, preach till all I know, and work till he stops me. And when he comes, my banner will be clear. Amen. You bow your heads with me. We're going to bring tonight's offering. Woo! Father God, Lord, we just thank you truly for what you're doing in this body. This body. We have the body that we call set free. The body of Christ. Father God, what an amazing thing. So Father God, just continue to grow, push us, move us. And maybe we need a little bit of trimming too, Lord. Because we want to get closer to you. So Father God, tonight we give. We give because of the joy that you've provided us. We give because of the life that you've provided us. We give because of the love that you show us. So Father God, we just praise you. We honor you in all we do. We're going to lift your mighty name up. We love you so much. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Stand with us tonight. Amen.
The love is
alive. If you've received Christ, he's alive in you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Isn't he good? You know, he's more than, worship's more than a song. So this is just great. We can sing. But worship is your life. So tonight, sing with your whole heart. Give him all of your heart. And just let him come and minister to you in a special way. As you reach out in faith, he'll meet you right there. Amen.
Great.
Prayer tonight. Wherever you lead us, Lord, we will trust you. Thank you. We thank you.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear, coming after me. Come on, it's for you too. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
That you won't even destroy, Father God. Lord, we thank you that your favor is for us, that you shine upon us, Father God. Lord, you pursue us when we run from you. Your arms are always outstretched. Your arms are all waiting for us to climb into them with the Father's love. We thank you for that. We thank you for your grace and your mercy, Father. We thank you that you call us by name. We thank you for this place tonight. Lord, I thank you for each one that's here, Father God. I pray, Lord, that you speak to their hearts tonight. Lord, as we worship in your word, Father God, I pray as the words open, we pray, JT speaks the word, Father God, Lord, to penetrate our hearts. Lord, that we would not leave here the same, that we would leave here changed. Lord, you said that we need to renew our mind. Lord, let your word renew our mind. Wash us in your word. Lord, we give you the praise, the honor, glory for everything that's said and done here tonight. Lord, let us not leave the same. In Jesus' name, amen.
You know, there's a story about a guy named Joshua.
From the Bible?
Yeah. Yeah, that's the one. God told him to build a memorial out of stones.
Yeah, and the stones were to be a reminder of this great thing that God had done.
So, we know it's not the same thing, but we were wondering if we could remember your dad with you. Remember all the great things he's done.
Sure.
So this one here, this one's for remembering a great friend.
This is for his part, keeping my kids safe at night.
You got one?
Not yet.
Not yet, okay. This one's for him being the reason I even know anything at all about the Bible.
Yeah, me too, actually. This is for dragging us to church that first time.
This is for freedom to worship and his sacrifice for that.
This one's for not letting his best friends stay mad at each other.
You know, he loved the simple things. Things like people getting to speak their mind or having dreams and pursuing them. This is for defending those things.
You know, you don't have to do this if you don't want to.
I want to.
It's okay, buddy. Just take your time, then.
This one's not just for my dad, but for all the people like him who helped protect their country.
I'll skip to that one.
God really is amazing. So tonight, everybody's kind of wondering, okay, what's going on up here? So you and I are going to have troubles tonight. We might have to.
You know how to
jitterbug? There you go. That might work better. So we're going to go one. Okay. Oh, well. Do I even know how to tangle?
No,
okay. I can jitterbug, yes. So if you were with us, I think it was 7 years ago, in about that vicinity, that I did this. I stole this from a buddy of mine in Texas, Sal Saberna. Pastor Sal, and I seriously can't believe how we've been married the same amount of years, our birthdays are the same, we've been in ministry the same amount, and the first time I met Pastor Sal, he was up here doing a conference for us, and he was actually doing this table talk, and a guy named Pastor Curtis wanted to know a place to go eat, and so I took him to 2K's. Everybody knows where 2K's is? Anywhere from, yeah. And so, 2K's. You've been to 2K's. Yeah. And
I've been there before.
Sal was dressed just like me, or, you know, he's mainly a blue jean dude. We're sitting at the table, and we're talking, and we're sharing back and forth of what things are going on. And come to find out, this dude was a pastor of a church of around, I don't know, 25, 30,000 people. Huge mega church in Houston, Texas. And it kind of humbles you when you sit around another guy that just loves the Lord, doesn't come across like, yeah, I got a church of 30,000. He just loved Jesus, and his whole, he was trying to change the thinking, change the momentum, change the environment of that church to discipleship. Because he said, man, we got a lot of people, but they're about that deep in the Lord. And what he was trying to do was change them from being that deep to growing in the Lord. And through the discipling, they started all these small groups. And I don't know if you've ever heard of RLM in Idaho, but this is where it all kind of initiated out of, with Jim Putnam and all those guys over there. And so this is where this table thing kind of came up. And so for the next few weeks, we're going to kind of go through the chairs. This one here, please don't. I don't want the big weep. We're going to shoot this one. This one here. Kind of beat up, rat-tailed. All this one. And I'm just going to read it off the thing. This is the spiritually dead chair. There are people in this stage have been not yet accepted Christ as Lord, and they may completely reject God. They may be seeking God, and they may be spiritual. They even claim to know God or to be a Christian, when in reality they're their own God. And tonight, some of you might be some of you sitting in here. You might think, yeah, I'll just say it. You might think you're saved, but you've never truly turned your life over to Jesus Christ. It was just a head thing, but it really wasn't a heart transformation. And you're still sitting in this chair, and you can't figure out why things aren't changing. Well, without the Holy Spirit living and dwelling within you, you're not going to change. How many have decided before, and I can go through the, I'm going to quit drinking, I'm going to quit smoking, I'm going to quit doping, I'm going to quit something, and you've said, I'm going to do it by myself. Anybody out there done that? Oh, the rest of you need some help. And how many of you, by doing it yourself, accomplished that? We've all tried to quit stuff. And we can try and try and try and try and try. And it's, who always gets in our way? Me, myself, and I. And so without the Holy Spirit within our life and controlling us, leading us, guiding us, there is no way we're going to change. And so to get out of this chair, you've got to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Not just here, because a lot of people say the prayer just to bail them out. Anybody ever ask Jesus, and I promise I'll never do it again. And 10 minutes later, you did it again. You might have made it a week, month. Some of you even made it a year. But I'm putting me in this box too. We did it again. Anybody ever pray to the porcelain God and say, Father God, I'll never do this again? You've got your face in a place that your face should not be. Praying, Father God, please. And then we get well. Well, I won't say we get well, but we feel better, and then we go right back out and do the same thing. So until the Holy Spirit comes in our life, and you know the funny thing about it is, when I got saved, I was praying every day, I was reading my Bible every day, I was doing this thing every day, and I was a fireman, so I worked 24 hours on, 24 hours off. And for the first 6 months I was saved, I was drunk every other night just like I was before. Well, you say, well, how? You weren't saved. Oh, I believe I was. I was fighting, trying to find out who Jesus really was. And some of you have heard this story before. Nona was raised in the Methodist Church, and I was raised in the Lutheran Church. And so I got the grand idea that I'm going to go back to church. And went to the church, and she didn't want to go with me because she was raised Methodist. You know how that goes. Come on. How many of y'all was raised Catholic, Methodist, Lutheran, Baptist, whatever? And when they first tried to get you in there and they were trying to get you to go to a different church, you're like, you know, I've heard all about them guys. Anyway. So I went to the Lutheran church for a while, and I got zip out of it. And so we decided we're going to go to the Methodist church. And I don't know how long we were going there. 2 months? Oh, we went twice. I thought I was doing better than that. So the second time I'm there, thanks, Noan, we are sitting in the balcony, front row of the balcony. And somewhere in the middle of the service, I fell asleep. And I almost hit my head on that banister railing. And I said, I'm done. If this is what Jesus is all about, if this is what church is all about, I am done. Now there's a guy sitting in here who pestered me, prodded me, pulled me. He never did beat me. I had him up against the wall once, but never gave up on me. I'm talking about Leo in here. I still can't believe we're still in here together. It's just the years, I mean, just it goes, it's unbelievable. But all the places I was at a wine and cheese party, drunk off my rear end. I was getting ready to do security, so I had to be liquored up to do security, you know. And a really good friend of mine, we got to talking about church. And she said, you need to go where my boy goes. And I'm like, I've been to I don't know how many churches. I am not going to church. She says, I'm serious. You need to go try it. Now remember, I had prayed, and I really did pray sincerely for Jesus to come into my heart. I was trying, you hear how that I is in there a lot? I was trying to find, I guess, what I was looking for. Still reading, still drunk on my rear end, praying every night when I was home, but still no peace, no comfort, no joy, basically no nothing. So I don't know what gave us the wild hair idea, but we decided we were going to go to this place where Joyce told us to go. And one of the biggest, ugliest black men I've ever seen in my life is standing at the front door and reaches out and hugs me as I come in there. And I always tell you, don't go on feelings, because feelings will screw you over every time. But something happened when Walter Hooker hugged me. And I still get goosebumps every time I talk about this. I could feel something. And it's like, I'm walking in the thing going, oh, man, what? I'm thinking, man, did I take some dope or something that morning? I mean, something happened. And we get in there, and Mama's all twisted up because there's no hymnals.
Right.
There's no cross. People are clapping, raising their hands. And she's like, we got to get out of here. This place is a cult. True? And I'm thinking, man, there's something in here. I got to have this, whatever it is. And she's dragging up. We got to get out of here. And I won't get into that whole story. But that's the day my life started shifting. And then Leo and I, of all places again, get hooked up, baptized in the Holy Ghost. And after that happened, then it was all over but the shout. Then my wife thought I lost my mind, thought I joined a cult, was going to start shaking bells at the airport and handing out pencils. Some of you don't even remember that. But that's when the Holy Spirit entered my life and things changed. And I can't explain it to you. I just can tell you that, and she'll tell you, I lost every one of my friends except one. Every one of them except one. And then that dude happened to get electrocuted to death after this had happened. And craziness. But what I want to touch on just tonight is that chair. The dead chair. If you do not have Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, guess what? You're never going to change. You'll change for a little bit, but then guess what? You're gonna fall right back in it. How many times have, and I'll just point out me, how many times I said I was going to change, I was going to quit, I was going to do this. And I did good for a while until stress, until disaster, until something happened in my life. And guess what I did? Turned right around and went right back to the crap. I know I'm not the only one in here who done that. So I'm kind of begging you tonight. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I usually don't guarantee nothing, but I will guarantee this. If you're truly honest with Him, and it's done from your heart, things will change. Now, don't think you're going to be Tiny Tim tiptoeing through the tulips after this. Now, about for the first week or two, it'll be you'll be, whoo. Some of you might even make it a month. Whoo, everything's just flying. Man, God is so good. Praise the Lord. Y'all need to get Jesus. And then life happens. Hello? And then we find out if it was a life-changing event or if it was a flash in the pan. Now, we're all going to stumble. But what do we do when we stumble? Do we get right back up? Do we ask for forgiveness and get right back up? Or do we get swept along and get swept out the back door and just sit in our pity party for the whole time? I'm telling you, if you get Jesus, it will be a wild ride. There are going to be, we talked about this in devotions, the mountaintops and the valleys and everything that's in between. You can't live on the mountaintop. It sure be nice. Stay up there, but there's no water up there. There's, if you get above the tree line, there basically there ain't nothing up there except you can see for. Yeah. My, wow, this is beautiful. Ever been to the top of the world outside of Red Lodge? You get up on top there above the tree line and you can just look at the, man, it's just beautiful up there. But even in July when we go up there, there's snow still up there. You got to wear your coats and stuff. You freeze to death up there. You got to come back down in to the real world. And we've been talking about this quite a bit. You know, somebody was asking that a while back, how come you don't do testimonies anymore? I was counting all the people that had came up and given their testimony. And if you've been around here long enough, if you look around to the people that gave you a testimony, 95% of them are not here. Well, why is that? Because they got attacked right after they got done giving their testimony of how great God is, and the enemy took them out. Now, some have come back. But I literally said, we gotta stop this. We're getting, people are getting saved, coming up sharing Jesus, and then we're finding them drunk on the street. So hopefully we'll get back into that. And talking about baptism, we're talking about that too. We watch all these people get baptized and then, oh my gosh, where are they? So you two, when you're getting baptized tonight, we're going to be holding it on a short leash.
Thank you.
But let me hit these other chairs. So we go from spiritually dead. You get a hold of Jesus. And you're just like the baby. You're just like the baby in the high chair. Now, I've got some grandkids, so we got a little bit of experience on what happens in these high chairs. Most of them don't look like this. Especially if the grandkids been in it. There's usually stuff running down the sides. This looks like there's been a mass murder on it. And they've usually got stuff in their hair, on their face, dripping down their clothes. They've got it in their ears, coming out their nose. And they got a big smile on their face. Right? So when you get saved and we move into this high chair, we're the infant that the Lord is the Lord of their life. They're confused about what truth really is, though, or they're beginning to learn what the real truth is. And they might say, Christians are hypocrites. And anytime anybody says Christians are hypocrites, my first answer is absolutely we are. And then I'll tell them, as soon as you find the most perfect church, don't go in there because you'll screw it up. I'm talking to all of us. If you find the perfect church, don't go in there because you'll screw it up. So how many of you know there ain't no perfect church? Especially not this one. We got a bunch of meatheads in this one, including your pastor. Oh, no. Are you serious? Okay, I got to go fast. So this one says, I'm a good person. A loving God would never send me to hell. The church just wants my
money.
See, you know that one. I'm too busy for a small group. Now, don't raise your hands in here. But how many of you are involved in a small group around here? If you're not, you need to get plugged into a small group. We can't take care of you here on a Saturday night. Just can't do it. But the small groups can. And the cool thing this week, I kind of watched our crew this week. Cowboy's going to get mad at me, but Cowboy had surgery this week. And get over there and find out there's already been people already over there to visit him. That's what the small group's all about, is you become family, you're looking out for each other, you start, man, if you need something, I'll be there. I'm never going to finish this in time. I got to tell Brian Gideon, I can't ever say the guy's name, Moose Story. He had a guy that was coming to his small group, just got saved, had been saved for about a week, and he was teaching the discipleship part of it. He had 150, 200 some pastors from all around the world over there teaching them about this discipleship program. And got done, went home, and as he's on his way home, he gets a call from this guy's wife that had just got saved, and I can't remember the guy's name, says, oh my gosh, he's got a moose down, and I don't know where he's at. He needs help. So Brian got all the guys that are in his small group. They found him. They helped get... Now, anybody ever been around a moose? Moose are not like deer. Moose are like semis. And trying to get that cut up and get it into the... Well, by the time they got it in the cooler, all of that, it was 3:30 in the morning. And he said, the funny thing about it was, is he's sitting in the trucks getting ready to say goodbye to the guy. And he said, this guy was a man's man. He's crying, sitting in the passenger seat. And he goes, you know, what's up with you? He says, I now know what the church is all about. Brian looks at him like, what are you talking about? He says, well, I just know what the church is all about. And he says, what do you mean? He says, we help each other no matter what time, what place. The church is there for, and what's the church? Us. The church is people. We're there, and that's what those small groups are there, is to help you get, and those that are going to get baptized, you probably better go get ready to get changed and get ready to go here. Because if I don't, I'm going to keep jabbering here. So here's a guy that's been saved for a week and gets a revelation about how great the church is by his homies coming and helping him haul a moose out of the woods. How many of you know church is fun? But this is just a party in here. The real stuff happens out there. The real stuff happens in that small group. That's where you can get down and dirty with people and find out the true stuff, what's going on. And, you know, I'd hate for you to come up here and confess your sins in front of everybody up here, because somebody will use that against you. I'm just being honest. Now, there's some people ain't going to go tell on you around here, but some people will run right out the door, right down the street, and go find somebody and say, did you know what Norm did? You're welcome, buddy. Right? That's what those small groups are. Get into a family that loves you, will confront you, will love you, will encourage you, and away we go. All right. While they're getting ready. So a little booster chair is the child seat. You move from the high chair to the booster chair. From there we move to the child's or the young adult's chair, and we'll just pick these out and then to the parent's chair. I didn't get any of the scriptures, did I? Matthew 28 at the end, we all know that one. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is what this is all about. Is getting there. Go and. The first word is go and make disciples. It doesn't say go and make converts. Because, you know, as you go to make disciples, the people are going to see you, what you're doing, and they're going to want what you have, and then you're going to make a convert and hopefully into a disciple. How many people here, don't raise your hands, have somebody discipling you on a weekly basis? And then those of you that are doing that, how many of you are discipling somebody else? That's what this whole thing's about, and we'll get to it. You boys back there? There we go. Who's first in the tub?
I'm still waiting on Robert.
Go ahead, Jess. Just jump in here. So hit Jess, Jesse's.
Hello, I'm Jesse Gratz. When I was first baptized, I was 13. And when I was in high school, 250 kids came up to me and asked who God was. And the next day, they all got saved. But I was mostly doing worldly stuff. And I backslid. I turned my life to God now because when I was first baptized, I fell back in the in world. And now I want to be born again. What's happening now in my relationship with God is God has shown me how to be more compassionate to people. I renounce my past life and accept and receive the mercy of and grace of Jesus Christ over my life. I give Jesus Christ rule and reign over my life. Lord.
We're waiting for the Vato. Here he comes. All right. So, Jess, who's your Lord and Savior? There you go, buddy. So it is our privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yeah, there we go. Good job, buddy. All right, hit David's there.
Hi, my name is David Compton. I first came to Christ.
Hey, man, I got to get my phone because Randy wants a close-up of this.
Hi, my name is David Compton. I first came to Christ a few months ago during a time in my life where everything had come apart. My best efforts brought me to a place where I was all alone and all I wanted to do was die. I couldn't hold a job. I couldn't even take care of myself. During that time, I heard a small voice that said, "Come to me and I will take care of you." And I started following him. I ran into a man named Randy at Set Free Hardin, and he said that there was a program that I could get into. I turned my life to Jesus because I needed something to follow that wasn't going to use me and throw me away when they were done. I'm grateful and happy. Today, Jesus is teaching me how to be humble, honest, and forthright with everybody that comes into contact with. I don't use people anymore, and I'm very grateful for that. I renounce my past life, and I accept and receive the mercy and grace of Jesus Christ over my life. I give Jesus Christ rule and reign over my life.
So, David, who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ.
Amen. So it is our privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let them dudes dunk you, dude. Amen. Now I'm going to ask you to pray for those two, because I guarantee you they're going to get smashed. Not drunk smashed. The enemy's going to come after them smashed here. And David's been doing so good. When he first come to us, if you remember him, he could barely get a word out of David. Now the Holy Spirit's lit him up, and you should hear that boy talking devotions now. He's sharing all sorts of stuff, hidden, he's saying, "I am." It's just amazing what's going on with guys. When you really get Jesus, things change. Amen? Love you. Let me pray us out of here. We'll see you next week. Father, in Jesus' name, I just thank you for Jesse and David tonight as they stood in front and just proclaimed Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior and took that next step of obedience of being water baptized. Father, I just pray tonight that if there's somebody sitting in here tonight that has never asked Jesus Christ to be their personal Lord and Savior, Father, I pray tonight they would just say a simple prayer. Lord, I need you. I am a sinner. I believe you with all my heart, and I confess Jesus Christ as Lord with my mouth, and help me. I don't want to be going down the drain like that water is right now. So, Father, just bless each and every one. Help us keep our eyes focused upon you. Help us tell the truth, shame the devil all week, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Love you.